With his distinguished baritone, five-octave crooner voice, Ville Valo blends charisma and gothic allure both on stage and off. He's a fusion of Johnny Cash's presence, the Sisters of Mercy's vibe, and Elvis's swagger, all wrapped up in the lyrical elegance of Lovecraft, Poe, and Bukowski. As the mastermind behind him, he carved out a genre-defying niche, bewitching the world with dark anthems and soul-stirring ballads. Valo's evolution from the vampiric leader of him to the solo artist known today as VV is represented perfectly via him's iconic heartagram logo, something Valo gifted the world when he created it on his 20th birthday. The truly iconic image perfectly captures the juxtaposition of the music, with the heart representing its softer side while the pentagram conveys the heavier, darker elements. With VV, the heartagram has been updated to include two extra lines to form the moniker VV at its center. From him's iconic heartagram logo to his solo venture as VV, Valo's evolution is a testament to his artistic depth. His debut solo album, Neon Noir, was released in 2023, and it showcases his storytelling finesse, weaving tales of darkness and light. Valo has been taking VV to stages across the world and is hitting Aussie shores in mid-March. I was given the privilege and the opportunity to have a chat with Ville about his upcoming Australian visit and even brought him up to speed on his Aussie slang. I'm Ez, and you're listening to The Heavy Podcast. Please stick around and enjoy my conversation with Ville Valo.
Oh, howdy.
Hello. How are you?
Sorry for the wait. It seems that I can't keep my mouth shut.
That's totally okay. That is 100% fine with me. I actually have a funny story about you being late, because last time we spoke, it was me that got us in trouble. That was over a year ago, so don't worry, I'm not going to make you try and remember me. But
I do remember.
Yeah, well, that's lovely. I was very much conscious of making sure that we stay on track of time tonight so that I don't get us in trouble again with your management, because I'm pretty sure we went down a rabbit hole of talking about tarot and astrology and cryptid creatures and whatnot, and then next minute we were way off track of time. So
but it was worth it. It was worth it, you know. It takes what it takes, and you know, unfortunately, thankfully enough, time is not linear. But that's another rabbit hole.
Yeah, I was going to say, do not even start me on that one, because I could talk for hours on things like that. Well, thank you so much for joining me on the Heavy Pod tonight anyway, Ville. Or tonight, it's tonight for me. I imagine you're in a completely different time zone.
Oh, it's still, yeah, I'm a late bloomer. So it's still morning for us here in Finland.
Well, good morning.
Thank you very much. but yeah. Yeah, it's all good. It's all good.
What does the day ahead look like for you then? Have you got like just a day full of press meetings, or have you got some personal time like slotted away as well?
I haven't woken up proper yet, so I think I'll do some reorganizing of the studio. I like preparing stuff, so whenever the muse tells me to do so, I have the ability to start creating, you know, right at that very moment.
Nice.
So I'm just recabling stuff and tuning my, or restringing my guitars and doing that sort of like stuff you do in the interim, you know, keeps me close to the music but doesn't take my focus off the tour. So
sure, yeah, all the nerdy musician stuff.
Yeah, it's been interesting. Like my probably like the only hobby I have, next to music these days is probably electronics. I'm really bad at it, but I'm getting into it because there's a lot of stuff you need to be able to fix. And living in a country such as Finland, there's not a lot of techs around, you know, who can take care of musical stuff. And there's luthiers, like great ones. So I've learned how to solder and do all that sort of stuff. So it keeps me busy.
That's awesome, though. Having like an extra set of skills is just not. I'm very, very much one of those people that doesn't really like relying on other people. So I kind of get how that would be. You know, Yeah, relying on other people can end in bitter disappointment a lot of the time.
Well,
So
then again, it can be the best thing in life too. So it's a complicated balance
double-edged
between.
sword.
Indeed, it is.
Probably coming from a slightly bitter angle tonight because I've had just a really rough day and people have been the
Oh.
cause of all the problems. So, but I must say, I am really pleased to be ending it with a chat with you tonight. So, so thank you for turning my
Famous last word.
shitty day. We try not to get on topics of I don't know, weird and wonderful things, and we should be right. Keep it professional and then I'll be good.
I know. Well, there's professional and then there's professional. So, how long
Yes.
is a piece of string at the end of it?
Look, I feel like you and I could be a very bad combination because it's just all those philosophical open-ended things that we could just the rabbit holes, like you said before, that we could go down.
Yeah. Well, philosophical. I'm not sure if any of my philosopher friends would call it that.
Well, you are about to tour Australia, which is why I've got you on the line tonight. So I'll get to talking about that in a minute, though. But the last time we did speak was when you were just on the cusp of releasing Neon Noir. So given that that was a year ago, I imagine that you've like really settled into those songs and you have been touring fairly solidly. So how have the audiences taken to that solo material?
It took a wee bit. We started touring right when the album came out, and you could see in the audiences that they still hadn't had the time to live with the songs, and so it was getting better by the day. But I'm sure also that the audiences didn't know what to expect, with whether it's going to be that we're going to play him songs or whether we're not going to do that stuff, or whether it's going to be something completely new, or this nice transitional period. Musically speaking, but it's been going really well, all in all. We played about 120 shows last year, which is a lot for me. I've never been in a band like Iron Maiden who do like 250 shows for 3 years straight. So I never had the opportunity of doing anything that massive. So this is really good, and also the fact that we played a lot of, especially festival wise here in Europe, we played very different kinds of festivals. We play metal festivals and more also like mainstream pop things and everything in between. So that's a great way of as well seeing how the music resonates and what kind of people might tickle whose fancies. So it's been exciting. It's an ongoing journey. It's funny how time flies, like as you said, it's been a year or so, year and a week or around that. Yeah, it's I think it'll take me until early May once we finish the tour to sort of like realize what just happened. It feels like a big long dive, take all the breath you can, then you just dive in deep, and I think in May I'm gonna sort of like see what's on the surface again.
Yeah, sure thing. Do you think playing those festivals has opened you up to even newer audiences and fresh fans, I suppose, because you've always had, well, for a long time now, you've had a very loyal fan base. So I guess there's a difference between your long-term fans jumping on board with the new solo stuff and, collecting brand new faces along the way.
Well, we've been really lucky that there has been both. It seems that the people who like what him were doing haven't abandoned the ship, and then there's a lot of new people aboard, and a lot of people, those younger people who didn't have the chance to see him play live. So it's been a good mishmash, and oddly enough, there have been people who know the new songs better than the old ones, because I thought for obvious reasons that I was in the band with him for such a long time. We toured so much that that would be the sort of main attraction, those songs and the sort of like the golden oldies, olden goldies sort of thing. But no, it seems to be very well balanced, and there's a new set of fresh, 20-year-olds.
I imagine that you've still got like something of an attachment to the hymn songs, but it must be nice as well to see that people are latching on to that newer stuff.
Yeah, it's a continuation of what I've done in the past anyway, so it's not too far off. But But I think that's probably for an older musician such as myself. I think that's probably the biggest challenge and the biggest thing you're worried about when an album is released. It's like when you go on tour and if people only, you know, so like enjoy the older material, of course you feel that you've failed to a certain extent. But you do understand the allure of older songs because people have had the time to live with them for a long time and they might have become very special in some cases and so forth. So new music is always a bit of a challenge.
Yeah, especially when those older songs have been sort of a part of people's formative years. There's a whole other attachment to them then.
Thankfully enough, the formative years of globally speaking, they happen all the time. So there's always formative years for the new generation is happening. So there's this the chance for people to find out all sorts of music and that will influence and direct them and work as the soundtrack of their lives at that very, you know, important part of their lives.
Yeah, definitely. Are there any songs that have performed better in a live setting than you expected from the new catalog? I know that there can be quite a difference, in the life within a song, in comparatively to the recorded version versus how it comes across live.
Sure, we try to arrangement wise, we've been trying to keep them quite close as well with the hymn tracks. We haven't all of a sudden turned Join Me in Death into a reggae version or whatever. It's very close to the probably closer than what hymn did back in the day to the album versions. And and I think a lot of times with especially newer songs and being a vocalist, it takes a long time to get the so the muscles. Your vocal cords set in the right way. It takes usually years of singing. Like songs like Join Me in Death, I've sang thousands of times, so that feels like second nature. But some of the new ones still, I'm still learning my way around them, especially when on tour and playing, let's say, 5 gigs in a row and then traveling a day and then doing another 5 gigs. So, because your voice tends to not necessarily wear out, but it changes, the timbre changes and also if you can hit the high notes or the low notes or whatever as well. And so it's stuff that you're not supposed to be thinking when you're recording now, because then you're just following the sonics, you know, what sounds good to you at that point.
Yes.
But then there's those ugly truths that you'll find out later in life, you know, when you hit the road. But it's been good.
It's such a fine line too, isn't it? Sorry, I just cut you off. But it's a fine line, isn't it, to walk that line between portraying the emotion in a song and then technically pulling off. I'm a vocalist as well, so I understand that, you know, the technicalities of hitting notes and pulling off a certain sound, but also keeping true to the emotion behind the lyrical content.
Yeah, it is a complicated task. You know, I've struggled with that all my life, but but yeah, it's I think it's been working good in a way that songs like, let's say, When Love and Death Embrace from 97, it still feels like as current as it did, you know, when singing it. It feels fresh and it feels full of meaning to me, which is important, I guess.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, and full of meaning that is not too far off from the... maybe my lexicon has changed a bit along the way, both musically and verbally, but the emotional states I'm trying to, you know, convey or portray, they're not too different. Or it's still about the wistfulness and the sort of beautiful sadness and solitude and the catharsis that music can, you know, help us go through, get rid of some the you know, sonic shower, as we say.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think as well, like in terms of performing songs live, each audience is different. So I think often people think that our artists must get really sick of playing old material over and over and again for years. But if you're in front of different people every time you perform who are responding differently, you feed off them, and it's so easy to step back into that emotion with that song, you know, no matter how old the song is.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right. And then also the cool thing about the history of him is the fact that different albums were appreciated by different kinds of people in different areas of the world. So a song like Join Me in Death was massive in Europe when it came out, and Buried Alive by Love was pretty big in certain scenes, you know, when that came out. And then in North America, Rip Out the Wings of a Butterfly got played a lot on MTV2 or whatever it was at that time. And So it seems that there are different highlights when it comes to the older tracks as well, which is cool because it keeps us on our toes a bit and it doesn't feel the same origin every night.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so what's the song you reckon was the Aussies' favorite then? We're gonna put you right on the spot.
Yeah, well, as you should, you know. No, if I remember Soundwave and especially the side shows with that, it was, you know, we were surprised that there were so many people knowing what we actually did, you know, knowing the songs and stuff. I guess it's stuff from love metal that seemed to work really well, which I'm happy about because it's probably Venus Doom and love metal. Those are probably my favorites. So it's a bit more Left of a Center, a bit more Sabbath-y albums. So Buried Alive by Love worked out great.
Love metal was my favorite.
Oh, cool, cool. Yeah. Well, thankfully enough, there is a favorite. But yeah, it's if I remember correctly, it was. It's funny, like I mentioned the song "Join Me in Death," and it was a bit of a big crossover hit. It was number one in Germany and number one here in Finland, and we were all of a sudden this, you know, goth boy band doing all like teeny pop shows and stuff, which was weird. But it's, for example, that's one of the songs that if people haven't really heard it and we play that at a metal festival, people kind of don't know how to react to it.
Yeah,
and it's still like that, which is actually a cool thing. So you're able to throw people off, not in a negative way, but sort of like out of their take them out of their musical comfort zone for a wee bit.
Yes.
And I think that ebb and flow and that sort of like sense of David Lynchian otherness is important when it comes to music.
Yeah, hell yeah, definitely. What about new material then? Can fans expect any new releases from you in the near future, or are you thinking about starting anything new at this stage?
I've been working on some ideas, but nothing's finished yet. And to be honest with you, I've always been really bad at writing while on tour because that's the only focal point. You know, you wake up, start figuring out the set list. You get, you know, I steam my suit. Steam the you know, the creases off and the wrinkles off and that takes all my focus and all my attention and once the tour is over in May, I'll probably start working on music a bit more proper and to see where it can take me, if it makes any sense or if it doesn't. It's you can't really force it, but as I said earlier, it's when you create an environment where it is easy to be creative, it doesn't hurt. So it's good to have your stuff around.
Yes.
Be sort of like create an inspiring atmosphere, and that's what I'm trying to do at the moment. And then just wing it, as I've always done, as you're supposed to be. Just follow the muse and follow the spark and follow the sound and let it take you wherever it might take you. The process is incredibly psychedelic and yet invigorating and yet interesting, and you know, it's a cool mixture. It's like that love and metal coming together. It's both intellectual and spiritual and all that, at least for me, and that keeps me afloat and helps me get out through the pandemics, whatever it might be, the internal pandemics,
and the boring adult responsibilities of life.
What are those?
Well, I try to remain in denial about all of them, so it's not working out well for me, but anyway,
as it should,
here we are. When you come here in March, will the fans be getting a bigger dose of the solo material compared to the hymn stuff, or will you be, you know, doing sort of a good mixture of both? What sort of can they expect from the live shows that are coming up?
It'll be half and half. I think that balance works the best. It's fair for the audience. It's fair for me. You know, I've never enjoyed solo artists just to play new stuff and then maybe finishing off. We're playing four old numbers or whatever. We're doing the old and new back to back, so it's like zigzagging between the past and the present, and it's worked out great like that. Lovely. As it also breathes new life into the old songs, having, you know, playing "Join Me in Death" after "Neon Noir," and then it creates cool new tensions and new sort of like dramatic moments and the roller coaster
contrasts. And
yeah,
stuff.
indeed, and that's how I like it anyway, and I think it's cool for the people as well. So you don't have to know all the hymn albums, or you don't have to know the one and only Vivi album to enjoy the evening. There's enough all sorts of things going on. So That's at least how it's looking like. I'm sure that won't
Yeah,
change.
I did the maths and it's been 10 years since you were in Australia. So is there anything in particular that you're really looking forward to when you come back to visit again?
Getting rid of the jet lag is my first and foremost sort of like target. But it's been so special back in the day touring with touring the Soundwave, for example, because it was such a weird cookie left of a center and different sort of a festival, as the bands had a lot of time to spend with each other, get to know new people in the scene, have a few days off. We had great parties there, dancing disco until early wee hours of the morning, and all that stuff. It's always been great in Australia. We only flew over there maybe three times, or maybe four. But it's
Yeah,
not been many
sure.
times, so there's many new things to see and new faces to see, hopefully in the audience as well.
Yeah.
It's just I've always to myself, it doesn't feel like a full-blown world tour if you're not playing Australia. It just feels that it needs to be part of it, so like make it official. And I'm really happy that we were able to organize it so that we can fly over and play those dates. So fingers crossed everything goes well, and I'm hoping that everybody will stay healthy and safe and so forth, and it'll be good.
What about support bands? I did do a little bit of delving and I couldn't really see who you've got on the bill with you when you come over here. Have you got locals jumping on or?
We don't even know ourselves.
Oh.
We are, it's because I was the one asking the question, I think. When was it, like, in the summertime when we're discussing this thing?
Yes.
And I'm sincerely hoping that we could bring Zetra over, the band from London. They're going to be touring with us in Europe right after Australia. And it'd be great for them, I hope, and it'd be great for me because I love their music and it's a great weird combo. They haven't played Australia before, so fingers crossed that that might happen.
Yes.
Or otherwise, it might be something local. I don't know yet,
Yeah.
but I'm quite particular when it comes to support acts. I never usually want the bands to sound like the main attraction, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
Like we toured with we toured the States and Europe about a year ago. We toured with Kayla Mikla, the female trio from Iceland that have this sort of new wavy goth electronic thing to them, and it worked out so beautifully in tandem with the music we play, as it shares similar sort of emotional center or backbone,
Yes.
but the way we approach sound and music is very different. And I think that it sets the mood in a great way, but it doesn't wear the ears out of the
Definitely.
listeners. If you have two bands that sound exactly the same, or three bands, it's even worse. You're kind of like, you already been there, done that before even the main band starts. So
Yeah.
try to avoid that. Try to play it
And I think
safe.
it also detracts from those supports because like as an audience member, for example, if I was standing there, I'm less likely to get into them if I feel like they're a cookie cutter of what I'm there to actually see. Whereas if I saw them outside of that setting, I might be like, oh, this has got a hymn or a Valo kind of sound to it, and I like that. But if you're seeing them all clumped together, yeah, it detracts from the uniqueness of those bands.
And it's lots to do also with levels, like with the overall volume of the evening. I like the if in my case, I like if the opening acts are a bit more quiet, but they're not as noisy. With Kayla Mikla, it was great because they didn't have guitars, so it was basically the
Yes,
first
yeah.
time the people heard a male voice and guitars was during the opening song for ourselves. So it felt great. And we toured with a band called Caspian back in the days with him, and that band was instrumental, sort of like pop rock, and it worked out beautifully because it set the mood in a great way, and it was similar in emotion, but it was very dissimilar in other ways. But people, the audience were really appreciating the how it worked out. I think you can make an evening more special by making, really trying to figure out a good set of bands. It's not always about what's a
Yeah.
good band. It's about bands that fit together. So
Yeah. completely understand where you're coming from. It's yeah, you're setting a mood from the start of the night.
Yeah, and you're part of it, and you're part of the mood as a in this case as the headliner as well. So it's I think it what you're trying to create is an event, more or less, an evening with soda, as opposed to just two or three random bands playing their set and off they go.
Yeah,
it's more about trying to turn the venue into a bit more of an otherworldly experience, especially when having shitty, bittersweet days. You know, like yourself today seems. You know, it's you need to be taken out of that, the real world, the realities of being an adult. Responsibilities and so forth for a little bit. I think that's very important.
I agree. I was just about to say, being transported away from reality is what you pay money to go to a show for. I 100% agree with that. Yeah. Well, since it's been a decade since you were over here, I thought I'd just have a bit of fun with you. And I thought we might see if you're brushed up on your Australian lingo.
Not at all. Go for it. I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
About the local lingo. None whatsoever.
Okay. Well, I'm going to toss you right in the deep end here then with, if you'll indulge me in a little bit of a quiz.
Oh, Lord. Yes.
Your face just now. Hilarious. So I'm going to.
Where's my laptop?
No cheating. You can phone a friend. I'll chuck you some Aussie slang terms, and I'll see if you can tell me what they mean. So the first one is, if someone was to say you were a dobber, what is a dobber?
Dobber, well, it sounds like a knobhead, but this is the problem being a Finn, you know, that you come to a new country, you hear words like that, and you misinterpret everything by 100%. So I'll say it means a knobhead.
Well, do you know what? A dobber by default really is a knobhead, but it is a like a tattletale or some, yeah. Yeah. Like no one likes to be told on. Knobheads are the sort of people that tell on people. So yeah, you weren't far off.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, yeah, not too far.
I'll give you that one.
Yeah. Thank you.
If an Aussie says that they're going to the servo, where do you think they're headed?
Servo? Would that be a service station? I'm not quite sure.
Yes.
All right, fair enough.
You got it. What does it mean to nick off?
To nick off. I would hear that in terms of like, you know, all sort of. That's, you know, going away from, you know, just, yeah, that's how I would hear it. I'm going to nick off. Like, I'm going to nick off. See you tomorrow.
Yep, that's exactly it. Yep. To go away or to leave a situation. Yep. All right, you're doing well. If someone says they're feeling crook, what does that mean?
Crook. Oh, that can mean so many different things. It's an interesting one. It doesn't have anything to do with criminalities, that's for sure. I would think that it has to do with feeling under the weather.
Yes.
Oh, it does. Wow.
Ding, ding, ding. You got that one too? Ooh. Yep, it sure does. Jeez, you... I've downplayed. You know what you're doing here. You've downplayed this. What does it mean if someone is referred to as a dag?
Dag. Oh, man. Well, that could be a way, a weird sort of like intonation of the word dog as well. So it's tough to say, but I thought of like a testosterone-fueled example of male toxicity. That's how dag sounds to me, but it's probably something completely different. Dag. You should give me a hint.
How do I give it a hint? The word actually comes from the shit that hangs off the end of a sheep, but that's actually not what it that's not how we use it though. It is if someone's. I can't give you a hint on that one. It's really basically, I'm going to just give it to you. I'm just going to tell you it's someone who's being funny or humorous or being silly. If you're mucking around, you're a dag.
Okay. So give me a sentence. Got it. But it doesn't mean in a sense so being a cookie.
No. Or... So if someone's really funny, you might say, oh, he's such a dag.
Hey, the reason why I didn't get that one is the fact that we Finns are not funny.
This interview is going to be published, just recorded only, no video. So I can't like reiterate what your how deadpan your face just looked then. All right, let's keep rolling on. What is a snag?
Dag is snag. This sounds like two cartoon characters, the series after The Simpsons. Snag.
I can give you a hint on this one if you'd like.
They all sound like somebody being a drag. All of that, like dag and snag, like being a pain in the butt. But snag. Well, snag could also. It sounds like a bit like a kip. It sounds like a little nap you might take in the middle of the day. Oh, well, darling, I need to take a little snag.
But, you're quite cold. I'll give you a hint. It's something you eat.
Snag. I'm vegetarian, so maybe that's the reason. Maybe that's the reason. You know, if it's not vegetarian, I'm proud.
Yeah.
Proud to not know the word snag.
It's 100% not vegetarian. It is the word we use to describe a sausage.
Oh, snag. Well, where does that come from? Snag.
Yeah.
What's the etymology?
That is a great question. Snag. I don't know. I'm just a stupid Australian that just says it. But, you know, you go down to...
A small sausage is a nakki in Finnish. So snag is not actually that far. And okay. actually, if we go to buy a donut, you know, like a little shop in the middle of or a stand for fast food somewhere, we call it snaggery. So it has the word snag in it already.
Okay.
It usually means when you're buying a hot dog off the street or something. So I should have known this, but once again, I'm proud vegetarian. So that might have been the reason. And that gives me the sort of right not to know this one.
I'm going to have to look at the etymology of this word when I get off this interview, though, because maybe it was. Maybe a Finnish person came over here and it just got shortened down to snag.
Or the other way around.
Yeah, maybe. Okay, so we've got a couple more for you. What does Arvo mean?
What was that?
Arvo. It's spelled A-R-V-O.
Arvo. Arvo is actually a Finnish name. It's a man's name. It's kind of old school. It's like George or a Philip or something like that. Arvo. No idea what that could be. No idea. Arvo.
It's a time of day. That's your hint.
No, I don't even have the slightest idea. It could be AM or PM or whatever. But Arvo. I never heard that before.
It's afternoon. It's just our shortened.
Oh, afternoon. It's like in skater lingo when obvious is RV.
Yeah.
Which kind of doesn't make any sense, but it does make sense. Arvo. Okay, man. Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one.
What are you doing this Arvo? Afternoon?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, sure.
If you chuck a sickie, what are you doing?
If I chuck, I'm not sure if chucking is throwing it away or smoking it.
Yeah, it's throwing it away, but it's also, you are making it very apparent to me how weird.
Because you could use it in a way. Can you chuck me a cigarette or ciggy or a fag or whatever? Fag, yeah. You don't use any.
It's sicky, S-I-C-K-I-E, not ciggy.
Oh, I heard sicky. That you were talking about ciggy.
Yeah.
What's a ciggy?
Yeah, so if you chuck a sickie.
That sounds sick, but what could that be? Like asking a day off work because you're supposedly under weather, but you actually have a hangover.
Yes.
Oh, so sick is a day off for being ill, you know, being sick.
That's 100% what it is.
Right, yeah, pretending. Yeah, get away from your responsibilities. Excellent. Yeah. There is some logic to it, no matter how thin the logic is, but it can be found.
I got two more for you. What is an esky?
Esky? Well, it sounds like Eskimo, but esky.
You're on the right track.
It could be cone of ice cream, or then it could be ice in your glass. We have Eskimo. We have ice cream back in Finland called Eskimo. But now they're changing it because supposedly it's not a word you're supposed to be using these days anymore. So Which I completely understand. Esky.
You're on the right track.
Well, it's cold. It's something cold.
It's a cooler. So.
Oh, it's a cooler. Oh, okay. Yeah. That makes all the sense in the world. Yeah.
Do you know, like a portable cooler you take to barbecues and stuff, you put your drinks in, that's an Esky.
Oh, man, yep.
And last one.
Sure.
The last one is, if I say that we're going to do a Macca's run, where do you think we're going?
Macca's run. Is it as in Paul McCartney, Macca?
Yeah, M-A-C-C-A.
Yeah, Macca's run. To me, it just sounds like you're going bar hopping. But to be honest with you, no idea.
Oh, you would probably do a Macca's run after you go bar hopping.
So is it like it has something to do with eating then?
Mm-hmm. Again, you probably don't eat.
I don't do McDonald's, if that's where you started from.
Yep. It means you're going.
You know, I remember those days when I remember when you're completely sourced after a bar. And, you know, the sun is rising a bit and it started to get light again. And then you, with your last, you know, ounce of inner strength, you sort of like try to find an establishment where to get a hamburger in the wee hours of the morning. I do remember that.
Crawl your way through the doors.
Yeah, indeed. And how did it taste for a second?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, you put me on the spot here.
I know. I can see your blood pressure has gone up.
It is. Yeah, I'm squirming in my seat.
I do know what, though. I think you're going to be just fine. I think that you will. You might be confused for a second if you have any prolonged conversations with Aussies over here. But I think you'll work it out.
As I usually am anyway, so it doesn't matter.
We do have only the littlest amount of time left, so I might have to call it there. But we are really, really, really looking forward to having you back after 10 long years. And I believe your first show is beginning in Melbourne, which is my neck of the woods. So we're excited that you'll be kicking it off down here with us.
Yeah, we're playing Auckland a couple of days before. And that'll be interesting too. We only visited New Zealand once before with him, it'll be a lovely experience once again. And then we're well prepared for you in Melbourne. You know,
yeah, dust the cobwebs off, and
or in our case, but dust them on.
Yeah. Alrighty. Well, thank you so much for chatting with me tonight, and we can't wait to see you out here.
Pleasure once again.
New Zealand and Australia, mark your calendars. Ville Valo will be gracing the stages of Auckland's Power Station on Wednesday, March 13th, followed by a performance at Melbourne's Northcote Theatre on Friday, March 15th. Then catch him at Sydney's Metro on Saturday, March 16th, and Brisbane's Tivoli on Sunday, March 17th. Tickets are available now, and it promises to be an unforgettable experience, so don't miss your chance to witness the gothic magic that is Ville Valo live in concert. You've been listening to The Heavy Podcast. Thanks for joining me. Peace out.